Hi, everybody. I'm going to send out a little Q&A poll to see how many people are there now. Somebody asks. There's just two of us in here. It's me and Allie.
Hi.
So I'm Jacob. I'm the Maker Education Manager, and I manage this room you see behind me, the Maker Annex, where we usually do these kinds of workshops. Today, we're doing it online. And today, we're going to be doing a project where we use TinkerCAD to model an animal cell. And so to start us off, I have Allie Stewart here. She is our life science educator, and she's going to just talk a little bit about what an animal cell is. And we're a little distant. You can tell we're a little distance from each other because we're doing social distancing. So we're keeping 6 feet between us. But before we do that, I'm going to first send out one more poll. I want to see how many of you guys were able to get into Tinkercad. So you should see this question jump up on your screen. I'm seeing a lot of yeses, but some no's, and that's totally okay. For today's workshop, it is not necessary that you follow along on Tinkercad. And I did send out some instructions for how to register. So if you want to go back to your email and register so you can follow along, that's fine. But we're going to have to keep moving along now. And if you want, you can just watch us. We're going to be modeling on the screen. You can see us. And we're going to be talking about all the different parts of an animal cell. It's going to be really fun. So for now, I'm going to go ahead and let Allie just introduce herself and talk about what is an animal cell. And then we're going to switch over and just start modeling one. She'll tell us all about all the different parts.
Hey, everyone. I'm Allie. I'm the life sciences educator here at the museum. And I'm in charge of a few different exhibits here at the museum. Power Science Lab, where we do lots of experiments. And we're actually doing an experiment we were doing over spring break all about the cell and exactly like what the cell consists of. And so animal cells are actually cells that are in your body. So we have a lot of different cells that function differently. And they're not just in your body. They're also in other animals. That's why they're called animal cells. So they can be found in all sorts of animals, and there's all different types of animal cells. We have, and they function differently. So we have like our red blood cells that carry oxygen to our muscles and then back to our, back to our heart. We have our skin cells that help keep us a little bit waterproof. So they all function very differently, but they all have something in common, and that's their organelles. So it's the things inside the cell that do the same sort of function. And that's what we're gonna do. So we're gonna build a model of an animal cell and talk about all those organelles that are within that cell and what those functions are.
All right, so I'm gonna start. I see some people say they can't see. I don't know how I can necessarily help you with that, but I'm gonna start sharing my screen right now and hopefully that will pop up for you. So let me know if that pops up for you. Someone else asked, have you done this before? This is our first time doing this workshop. This is our third virtual workshop. So this is the third one. We did one earlier today that some of you are at, and then we did one last week as well. But we will be doing a lot more continuing forward until the museum is back open again. So definitely look out for those opportunities. So I'm going to start sharing my screen now. Here it comes. And let's see. All right. Let me know if you can see my screen. I'm going to put out a poll to ask, can you see my screen? Let's see. Seeing yeses. Yay. Most people can. Oh, there's one person who can't see my, two people who can't. Uh-oh. Well, hopefully we can get that figured out. Try to make sure you're in the right tab. Hopefully it looks like those no's are going away. Maybe it was just a moment where you couldn't see it. So I'm going to keep going, and what we're going to do is we're going to go to Tinkercad. So if any of you guys, I know a lot of you were able to get into Tinkercad. Even if you weren't able, that's fine. Just watch what I'm doing. You can just watch the video, and then maybe use the instructions later to get into Tinkercad and try to do the same thing. This is going to be recorded, and we will be sending it out to everybody once we get it up on platform. So just look out for that. That way you can go back, and anything you missed, you can watch it. So once you're in Tinkercad, you should see a screen that kind of looks like this. You probably don't have quite as many objects in your screen as I do. You might have none, unless if you've been using it before. If you don't see a screen like this, just touch the top left-hand corner where it says TinkerCAD. It'll take you to this screen. And to create a new project, you press Create New Design. And you would see a little loading screen. And then it comes here. And now we're not going to be able to really, we've been doing a TinkerCAD workshop on how the basics of TinkerCAD in the morning. So those were the ones that we've done so far. We're going to kind of go into it. We're not going to really look at how we move things around quite as much as in those basics lessons. So if you aren't able to follow along, that's okay. You can just start watching. I will go into a little bit of the basics. What I'm doing right now is I'm right-clicking and dragging to look around the screen. If you are on an iPad, you could also just click on this little cube in the top left-hand corner to see different views. So that's how you move your screen around. So we're in TinkerCAD. We have the work plane. What we are going to do is we are going to create a 3D model of this animal cell. And that's what Allie just told us about. So you can see it looks kind of circular, but we probably, it's not a perfect circle, right?
It's not a perfect circle, no.
So to create that outer, what would we call this?
That's the cell membrane.
To create the outer cell membrane, let's just start with that so we have something to work off of. We are going to go on our right here into basic shapes, scroll down, and find that scribble button. Now you click the scribble, and you come out to your work plane, and you click it to set it down, and it takes you to this different screen. And what I'm going to do is click draw shape on the bottom here. And just to make sure everyone's following along, I'm going to check our questions first. Is that okay? Yes, that's okay. I just want to make sure that I'm not missing anybody's questions. All right, so I'm going to go down to draw shape in the bottom, and I'm going to click right in the middle, and I'm going to hold it down. And I'm going to draw something that looks kind of like that shape. I'm going to get as close as I can. It doesn't have to be perfect. Does that look right, Allie?
Yeah, it looks perfect.
Looks good. All right. So once I have that little cell shape, I'm going to press the button done. And there we have our outer membrane.
Awesome.
I'm going to make it bigger. And then Allie's going to tell us what it does. So to make something bigger, you find those little white boxes in the corners. You drag it out. Now you can do it two ways. You can just drag it and kind of get it how you want, or if you want it to look exactly the same as it did when you first started dragging, hold the shift button and it will drag it with the same proportions. And then I'm going to make it shorter so that we can put our other things in it. And there we have our cell membrane.
That looks great.
Do you want to tell us a little bit about the cell membrane?
Yes, I do. So cell membrane is actually the membrane that lives around the cell and protects the cell from its outer surroundings. It's actually known as a phospholipid bilayer, which is a very big word. But what that really means is it's composed of a fatty layer, which is hydrophobic, so it's scared of water, and a hydrophilic heads, so they actually they prevent water from coming in and out, just rushing all through the organelles. It actually has a little barrier that it creates. It's very fluid and things can float in and out of it, but sometimes if it's a big thing, it can't actually go in, and they have proteins inside that membrane that let things in and out. Those are called transport proteins.
Wow.
It's a very complicated structure, but we're going to base it off of just the nice, simple idea.
Yeah. All right. So we got the basic shape of our outer membrane, which it sounds like does a lot to protect the cell. Okay.
Yeah.
Sounds like it does a lot to protect the cell. Looks like it's lagging. Da, 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 da. So to get there again, you press the create new design. The shape that I used to draw the outer membrane, and I'm sorry if there's lagging. That's just something we're going to have to deal with in some of these workshops because of the nature of the internet and connectivity and all of that. So I apologize. We will have a video of this available, though, if there's anything you missed because of lagging. So the shape that I used is it's in the basic shapes menu on the right, and you see there's the box, the cylinder, the solid box, the solid cylinder, the sphere, and finally scribble. So I used scribble to draw this. And when you set scribble down on your work plane, this is what shows up. And then you just kind of draw a shape. And I use the draw shape button down here. Now I'm not going to make another scribble. I'm going to get out of here because I already have my cell membrane. So you draw that here. I'll go back and do that again real quick in case you missed it, to do the, because the membrane seems like an important piece that everyone should have. So what you do is on the bottom right here, there's draw shape. It should automatically be on this pencil. That's not what you want. You want to go to this bottom right menu and click draw shape. Then you click right in the middle or close to the middle, and then you kind of drag it out. You should see a line appear. And you hold the click button down and drag it out, and then you just kind of make a circular. The whole point is that it's not a perfect circle. So that looks great to me. If there's anything missing in the middle, you can use the draw button to fill it in, and there you have your shape. So I've got another one here. I'm going to delete it because I don't need it. And here's my outer membrane. So what do you think we should do next? Should we do the nucleus?
I think so. I think that's the next biggest organelle.
All right. So an organelle called the nucleus.
Yes.
It's going to be these circles in the middle. So before we make it, I'm going to let Allie talk about what it is.
So if you see on that image, that big pink circle is actually the nucleus. And so the nucleus is going to house the DNA of the cell. And so, in fact, the DNA is in something, it's a tightly wound spiral structure that is actually inside the nucleolus, inside the nucleus. So if you see on our picture, you have the nucleolus, which is that yellow circle, inside that pink circle, the nucleus. So let's go ahead and create the nucleus that's going to help protect the DNA, because the DNA is the most special thing inside that cell. It literally tells the cell exactly what to do, when to do it, what proteins to build, and everything.
Awesome. All right. So we're going to do the nucleus.
The big pink circle.
The big pink circle first. And then we're going to actually do the nucleolus and the nuclear membrane. And we'll just kind of keep it the same colors as our cell on that picture there. So, obviously, we're going for a cylinder. So we're going to take a cylinder. You click it on the right-hand menu here, and then you put it out here. And so I think we're talking about doing, I think it was pink, wasn't it?
It was pink, yes.
All right, so I'm going to have it sticking out a little bit so we can see it. And, well, that looks kind of like an egg, which is interesting. Let's pull up, see. Yeah, that looks about the right size.
Yeah.
We can always resize it later. And actually, no, that looks about the size of the nucleolus. What happened to it?
It did look like the size. You brought it down below the.
There it goes. Oh. All right.
It does look more like the nucleolus.
So we'll make that our nucleolus, and we'll keep it yellow, and then we'll make our nucleus. And so I'm going to have a very similar cylinder here. I'm going to drag it out to be bigger, and I'm going to make it about the same height. And again, to reshape things, it's these boxes on the corners here. You just kind of click them and drag them. You can also just click it, and you see these little numbers. You can just change those numbers to try to make it a different size. So I think that 50 looked better. So I'm going to go with 48 maybe, even, just to make sure there's enough room for everything else. And these are the same color, which I think that we should change so that we can differentiate. So I'm going to make that pink like it is in the picture. Make sure that the thing inside is a little bit taller so it doesn't get covered up. And there we have our nucleus and our nucleolus. And real quick, I'm actually going to go ahead and make the nuclear membrane.
Yes, so the nuclear membrane is going to be the edge of the nucleus. And it's actually, again, a phospholipid bilayer, just like our cell membrane. So it protects the nucleus and what's inside the nucleus just as much as it protects what's inside the cell.
Okay, so it's kind of the same thing as the membrane we already made, just specifically for this inner part.
Correct.
With the nucleus that we've just created. So I know this is a lot of science, guys, and if you're not catching every vocabulary word, that is just fine. We're just kind of exploring what a cell looks like and getting an idea. We're not all going to be microbiologists by the end of this workshop, but maybe we'll be a step closer, right?
Yes.
All right, so I'm going to put this. That looks maybe a little too thick. I'm going to make that. Again, if you press this corner button, you can make specific changes to the actual size. Just make it so it's just barely around there. And then I'm going to check our questions to make sure that we aren't leaving anybody behind here. Make that red, oh, a little too red. Make it a little shorter so that it's in the right order. Maybe it looks pretty good to me. I'm going to check our questions now and see what everyone is Why does the nucleus have to be a circle? What do you think?
It's actually a good question. You don't have to use a circle. It's usually just how we draw it. But lots of times you're going to find the nucleus and it's just a big blob, similar to the way the cell is a big blob. The nucleus takes up most of the cell and is actually very big and wavy looking. But for our learning sake, most of the graphics you find online are going to have it drawn as a circle for simplicity.
So it's a blob. It is also a blob, but we're just representing it as a circle because that's how the graphic is representing it.
But that was a great question.
Yeah, it was a really good question. Someone else asked if we are going to be doing this every day at 2. Yeah, you can use a ring instead. That's a good idea. I mean, however you find that you want to represent these things, there's not only one way to do this. So I'm doing it however seems the right way to me at the time, but you can do it however seems like the right way, especially if you're already kind of well-versed in Tinkercad. So somebody asked, will you be doing this at 2:00 every day? We'll be putting out a schedule. It's not every day, but it might change next week into every day. Someone says they can't see my screen. I'm sorry about that. Hopefully it'll pop up right now. This is, we're just going to keep going with our cell. So here is what we got so far. We have our outer membrane, which protects the entire cell, right?
Yes.
And then we have our nuclear membrane,
Nuclear membrane,
which protects our nucleus. We have our nucleus, which
houses our nucleolus, which is where our DNA resides.
Sorry, guys. It says that it stopped. It's coming back on. I don't know what happened. I must have accidentally hit the stop sharing button. I'm sorry about that. Is it back? Let me put out a... Can you see my screen again? Oh, it's back. It's looking like it's back. I'm sorry about that. I probably accidentally hit the button. Okay. So, again, our nucleolus. And I'm actually going to take a second here because we have some fun questions. And I'm going to start a poll to see, can anyone tell me where is the nucleus? Nice. Yep. We all know that the nucleus has met the cell, so that last answer is probably not correct. So yeah, it looks like everybody's starting to get it. That's awesome. And then I think I have another one about nucleus too, right? I think we talked about... where do you find DNA? Is that a good question to ask?
That's a good question.
Okay, so let's see. Where do you find DNA? Awesome. You guys are following along. Great. This is amazing. Outer membrane. It's actually in the nucleus. Golgi apparatus is a very funny word. We're actually going to get there soon, but good job, everybody. It is within the nucleus. All right, so let's go ahead and continue. What part should we make next? What do you think?
I think we should try to make the mitochondria next.
The mitochondria. So that's this guy on the bottom left here. It looks like there's two of them.
There's multiple ones.
Oh, four of them,
cell,
yeah.
But it depends on the type of cell of how many mitochondria actually are there. In our muscle cells, we find a lot, but in our skin cells, we don't find very many at all.
Okay. So we're going to make the mitochondrion. And what tool do you think we should use? Should we use Scribble again, you think?
You can use Scribble. What if you use, since it's a, they have the half sphere.
Half sphere, okay.
Maybe something like that. Can you elongate the sphere?
Yeah, you can make it longer, yeah. All right, so we're going to use the half sphere. If you want to make it more squiggly, you could try using this what is it called again, Scribble, and just scribbling a shape. But we're going to use the half sphere for now.
Turn it upside down.
So, I see, okay. So I'm going to stretch my half sphere to be more like the shape of this mitochondrion right here. Looks like it needs to be a little bit more like that. And then I'm actually going to flip it upside down. So I'm going to click it, and I'm going to press. You see this little curved arrow button on the top here? I'm going to click that, and I'm going to turn it upside down. And something I like to do when I'm rotating an object is hold the shift button. And it makes it so it just goes in 45-degree angles like that, so you can turn it right upside down instead of just getting, like, close. Like, this wouldn't look quite right. So if I hold shift, I can get it perfectly upside down. And it was right around here? Yeah. Maybe? Yeah.
It actually can be found anywhere in the cell, just not inside the nucleus.
Okay, so it's in the outer membrane, and so it kind of moves around the cell, or?
No, it'll sit pretty stagnant, but you can find them anywhere inside
okay.
a cell.
Okay, yeah. So they don't have a specific place they have to be. I think I am going to try to follow along with our map here just to get as close to that as we can. So I'm going to put it like that, one, and then I'm going to do copy and pasting. Let me just check on our questions real quick. Why does the cell have so many parts?
That's a really good question. It has a lot of parts because each part does something very specific. And just like our body has a lot of different organs that do very specific things, like our lungs are made for just breathing, our muscles are made for moving, and our eyes are made for seeing. So we have all sorts of organs that do specific things. Cells have all sorts of organelles that do specific things. So our mitochondria are specific. They're called the powerhouse of the cell. And that's actually what they create the energy we need to move. So they're the parts of the cell where they're going to take the glucose or the sugar that we eat, and they're going to break it down into energy, known as ATP, which is a fun little letter sequence.
Cool.
But yeah.
Yeah, so I guess every single one of those parts or organelles
has a specific function.
I do see somebody is raising their hand. I don't think we're not really using the raising your hand function in this. That's usually for if we're going to give people the ability to talk. But really, any questions you have, please put it into the Q&A. So I'm going to answer these in order. I see, can you clone a shape? That's actually exactly what I was about to do. So I'm going to take this mitochondria, and there's two ways to clone it. You can do copy and paste. So you see on the top left here, you have the copy button, which is the two squares, and you have the paste button, which is the clipboard with one square. So I'm going to do that first. Copy, paste. And there goes my second one. And I'm going to rotate them like that and move them over here. But you could also press this third button with all the different squares, and that's the duplicate button. And if you press that, it's going to appear right on top of your previous one. But what you can do is you can move it. And something interesting about that button is if then you move it away and press it again, it'll put it the same distance that you moved it the first time, which can be useful when you're doing other things. It's not really putting it in the right place for us, but, you know, it's good enough. So I'm gonna just have three mitochondria.
That sounds great.
That's fine. We had another question. Why is it called the nucleus?
So the nucleus is actually a Latin word that means kernel or seed.
Oh,
and so it's actually the seed and kernel. It's the, you know, the heart of the cell, pretty much, like in the sense that you can plant that seed and that seed has all of the genetic material you need for that plant to grow.
Oh, okay. So it's because nucleus is from Latin for seed.
Yes.
Just repeating to make sure everyone heard. How small is a cell?
Oh, that's a very good question. So it depends on the type of cell we're talking about, but let's say like a red blood cell.
So we're going to find out how small a red blood cell is. This is one kind of cell.
So a red blood cell is approximately 6.2 to 8.2 micrometers, which is 0.00062.
Wow. So
it's very small.
The answer is it's very, very, very small. When we have one more question about cells and then a question about how to use the program. So first we'll go, why don't the mitochondria move?
That's a good question. So they don't have actually any muscle or ability to move. In fact, like if you don't actually have the structure to move, you can't. So it's like if you were a body and you didn't have any muscles, you just kind of lay there. And so that's kind of what the mitochondria do.
Okay, so it doesn't have any muscles. All right, and then somebody asked, my cell is going on top of my organelles. Is there a way to fix that? Yes, there is. So you can grab your membrane, if you're talking about this, and just make the top center square, you can drag that and make it shorter. And that way, It's you just make each piece shorter than the piece that it's supposed to be on top of or below. And that way you can kind of order it in that manner. So I'm actually going to make these guys go down a little bit. So yeah, it's that top white button. You just drag it down. So you want to make sure that they're the ones that are supposed to be on top are taller than the ones that they're on top of. That's basically what you want to do. Double check anymore. So somebody asked, and then we'll move on to the next piece. Is this the only cells in animals?
So all animals will have animal cells. Like, we won't have any plant cells found in our body. But the different type of cells will have a different amount of those organelles that we see. So it might look a little bit different if it was a red blood cell or if it was a skin cell. But they're pretty much the same.
Okay. And then one more question before we move on to the next organelle. How many are in your body?
That is a great question. There is about 37.2 trillion cells in your body.
Wow.
That's a very big number.
That's a lot of cells. Okay. And somebody asked, let's just keep going because these are really good questions and I want to get them answered. Do the cells depend on size or no?
Some cells do. In fact, for instance, it really depends on the function of the cell. But like our skin cells, you might see them actually look a lot longer and flatter than our muscle cells. Because our skin cells actually help protect us and keep our body waterproof, in a sense. So if you get water on your skin, you can just wipe it right off. It doesn't absorb through your skin. And so it needs to be layered really tightly, nice and flat on top of each other, those cells. But our muscle cells are nice and plump because what they do is they have to contract in order for the muscle to move our body. So yeah, they change in size and shape.
All right, I see a lot of good questions, but we're going to go back to TinkerCAD and then we'll come back. We'll answer all of your questions unless that they start coming in like hundreds at a time, in which case we might take that back. But we will answer all the questions that are on here. But first, we're going to just go back here. Somebody did ask if we could review what we did. Yes. First, we used the scribble tool to create the outer membrane. Then we used the cylinder tools to create the nucleolus, the nucleus, and the nuclear membrane. So those are three different cylinders that are stacked. And then we used, I think we used the half sphere, which we then stretched to be longer to create the mitochondria. And now we're going to move on. And what do you think? Do we want to do...
Let's do the smooth ER.
Smooth ER. So that looks extremely complicated. You can see it right there. I have my mouse hovering over it. It's that kind of blue crazy shape. Is that a shape that has to look exactly like that? Or can it...
No, what the smooth ER can look like, it's really a bunch of folded layers. Kind of like if you took a spaghetti noodle and you folded it up onto itself. That's really what the smooth ER looks like. So you could probably use the scribble.
Perfect.
To draw it.
So we'll do scribble, and I see it's represented blue. I want to keep it blue. So before I get there, I'm going to go ahead, click my outer membrane again, press this solid button where the color is, and I'm going to make it transparent. And that way my outer membrane looks kind of transparent. So it looks even more like an egg now. And that way the blue isn't going to blend in as much. All right. So scrolling up, still in my basic shapes, right next to sphere is scribble. And this is how we made the outer membrane too. So if you missed that part, this is how we did this first shape anyway. So you can see how to use the scribble. I'm just going to click right there, set it down, and I get into this screen. And I'm just going to use the draw tool.
And I would draw it like if it was like a wiggly fettuccine noodle.
Okay, so like, is that okay?
Great. It might be a little big. You can shrink that down, though. That's a little much.
It'll be fine. We can always shrink it.
Oh, that's
so
perfect.
Let's compare. So we have this, and we have this. Those look identical to me.
I think it's perfect.
Yeah, those are identical. I'm a regular Picasso. All right, let's move it. And it was, I think we're going to need to take our nucleus, maybe make it a little smaller. What do you think? Make some room?
Yeah, we can make it a little smaller.
I'm going to make my nucleus a little smaller.
Or you can make yourself bigger.
Well, I've already made it smaller, so I'm going to place, and let's see where the, and does this need to be, it needs to be right by the nucleus?
It should be close to the nucleus, yeah.
So this is supposed to be near the nucleus. I'm going to kind of stretch it and put it right there. That looks good to me. We can always move it around later. All right, so that is what we call the smooth ER. So Allie, do you want to tell them a little bit about what that means?
Yes. So the smooth ER is actually the site of what they say is lipid synthesis. Lipid synthesis, which means that's the site of where we actually make some fatty molecules. So what it's going to do is it's going to take small molecules and help build them into a fat molecule that we can store energy in, because that's really what fat is all fat is stored energy for us to be able to use later. And so our lipid synthesis occurs right there in our smooth ER, and that organelle helps make those fat molecules stay together so we can store it elsewhere.
Okay, so it's really all about, and I know paraphrasing is going to miss some of the points, but no, it's really all about storing energy, right?
Yes, storing
energy. Okay, storing energy.
I love it.
That's all right. Great. Awesome. Let's check on our questions real quick and just do a few of those, and then we'll go on to the rough ER, which is going to be a lot of fun, it looks like. Okay, so the next question was, when the cell is singular, where does it get the glucose?
So usually the glucose is actually floating around, and we usually get it from our blood. So we eat the food. We chew it up, swallow it, it goes to our stomach, and then to our small intestine. And from there, we absorb it into our bloodstream, and the blood delivers it to all of our cells throughout our body. That's why we have such small veins and arteries for our blood to deliver us all that nutrients and oxygen.
Awesome. I really like this next question. It's, what cell is the most important?
Oh, no, that's the hardest question. That's a very good question. I think that that's impossible to answer, because without them working together, if you didn't have muscle cells, you couldn't move. And I really like to exercise.
Yeah.
And like, if you didn't have a red blood cell, you couldn't breathe. I don't know. It's getting really complicated. Maybe I'll get rid of...
So basically all of our cells are important. We need them all.
Yes.
How big is the biggest cell?
That's actually
We'll try to find that out for you in a minute. I see some people saying that the screen is sometimes freezing. I'm sorry about that. That's just kind of the nature of this tool and using the internet in general. It might sometimes screen... Or the screen might sometimes freeze if either me or one of you guys has some kind of an interruption in our connectivity. So hopefully it's not happening too often. We are recording this, so anything you miss, we'll be able to send out to you. All right, so we're looking up the biggest cell. Also, how many types of cells are there?
Oh, that's a really good question. What we're talking about is cells inside our body and animal cells, but there are actually single-celled animals. So animals that are just made up of one cell, which is kind of mind-blowing to think about. And you can only see them with a microscope, except for one of our biggest cells we've ever discovered is from an animal. And I'm going to try to pronounce it, but it's going to be very difficult. It's Syngigamma fragilissima, which is can get up to 20 centimeters wide in just this one cell.
What?
Yes.
That's wild.
That is wild. I just Googled it, and so I'm very excited. Yes.
That's very cool.
It kind of looks like a slime mold.
Let me pull up. I'll pull up a picture of it so you guys can see this. Let's see. What is it called?
Syngigamma
fragilissima. Let's see if that... It looks like I got it right.
You got it.
And here is a picture of a 20-centimeter cell.
And see how it says, living beach ball is a giant single cell.
That is wild. All right. So that was a good question. I see probably what is my favorite question of all time, which is, this is awesome. I agree. Somebody asked how many mitochondria are there. I think that's specific to the cell.
Yes.
So how different cells have different amounts. There's not a certain amount. In the one we are looking at a model of, there are four. One, two, three, four. But it can be as many as you can imagine. Somebody is asking about the smooth ER. Several people are asking to review. So let's go over what we've done. So far what we've done, and again, I'm going to kind of, we want to keep going, so I'm not going to review for too long, and we will share the video, so if you guys want to go back and watch certain parts, that's okay. So far we've used the scribble tool to create our cell membrane, which is kind of like the protection for the entire cell.
Mm-hmm.
And then we've used the cylinder tool on the right here to create our nuclear membrane. Our nucleus and our nucleolus. I got it. And then we used our half sphere, which we turned upside down using the little curvy thing, and stretched to make it the right shape to create our mitochondria. And we used copy and paste in the top left-hand corner to create more mitochondria. And there is no specific amount that you need. It depends on what cell it is. So you can have three, you can have two, you can have four, whatever looks best to you. You can have 25, apparently. And then finally, we finished the last thing with the scribble tool.
The smooth endoplasmic reticulum.
To make the smooth endoplasmic reticulum or the smooth ER. And we just kind of scribbled like crazy to do that, which I think we're about to do again when we make our rough ER.
Yes. So you can either copy and paste your smooth ER because they look very similar.
Okay.
And then you're going to add something to the ER to make it rough. And those, what you're adding are little dots. Those little dots are called ribosomes.
Oh, those are ribosomes.
Yes.
Very cool. So I'm going to do what she just said. I'm going to copy and paste. Which you can do, again, you could either use copy, which is the two squares in the top left, and then press paste, which is the clipboard in the square, or you could press duplicate, which will put it right on top of it, so you won't see that it got copied, but then if you drag it, it will move. And I'm going to just rotate mine a little bit to make it look interesting. I'm going to make my rough ER purple,
sure,
just to differentiate it a little bit. And then I'm going to use, what do you think, sphere or cylinder?
I think sphere.
Let's do
ribosomes
spheres.
Are going to be little balls.
Okay, so we want to make little spheres, and we're going to need to make it very small. So I'm going to zoom in real close here. I'm going to press that corner button, and I'm going to hold the shift key down. If you're on a computer, you can hold down shift. Otherwise, you're going to just have to kind of use your eyes to make sure that it's staying a perfect sphere, which I don't know if that's even necessary. It doesn't need to be perfect.
It doesn't need to be perfect.
Doesn't need to be perfect. I'm going to make it smaller and smaller and smaller. Does that look around the right size?
It's a little big, but I think that will do well for our model.
Okay, that's fine for our model.
And do we want to change the color maybe?
Yeah, what color should it be? What do they have it as? They have it...
they have the ribosomes as purple.
Oh, well, let me change my rough ER to maybe just a darker blue. Yeah.
Ooh, that's nice.
And then I'll make my... And again, to change the color, I'll do it real quick for my ribosome here. I'll press solid. And then there's all these color options. So I'll make mine purple. Then I'm going to move it over, and I'm going to make it kind of sit on top of it. Is
yeah,
that right?
And they sit all around the rims, but I think on top is perfect.
Just for our purposes. And then I'm going to start copy and pasting it. So I press the duplicate key. I'm going to move it over. I'm going to copy and paste. I'm not going to do duplicate. I'm going to press the two squares and then the clipboard. And then I'm going to it's kind of hard if you're – So you might want to zoom in a little bit to be able to control it. I'm going to move it, and then I'm going to press paste again, and I'm going to move that one, and then I'm going to press paste again. And you want it all on the one that you've decided is your rough ER.
Correct. The rough ER, that's what it describes. The roughness is actually the ribosomes on that endoplasmic reticulum.
So I'm going to just do one more to represent it, but you don't want any of these on your smooth ER because that would make it rough. All right. This cell is really coming along,
y'all.
It looks
great.
Yeah, this is fun.
If you'd like, you can add a few random ribosomes to the cytoplasm, which is what's the liquid that's inside the cell. So we made the cell membrane, so they can just float around just like the mitochondria.
So some of these ribosomes won't necessarily be on the rough ER here. You can have some that are just
floating
free
around.
Floating in the cell.
Correct.
Here. So there we go. You know, can they be in just random places? Or
random
should they be?
Places.
Okay.
You want to make sure you leave room for your other organelles. But...
I can move them away later if I need to, but that looks cool to
awesome.
Me. Wow. What
it does
a cell.
Like a fried egg.
Yeah, it does. I
fried
really
egg
like
with
that.
Some chives on
yeah.
top.
All right. Let's hit some more questions. I kind of like this. If you guys disagree, let me know. But I kind of like this flow of we answer some questions, then we add another organelle. And then we answer some questions, and then we add another organelle. So we have, can cells die?
Actually, yes. Cells can die. In fact, they die all the time. So like when we shed when our skin cells fall off, that's usually when they're dead. But they regenerate in the sense that, so they usually create another cell and then they'll probably die off. And that's, so for instance, I think you've maybe some of you have heard that like your skeleton regenerates every so many years. That's actually because all of the cells that were on our bone cells, they ended up dying slowly, one at a time, after a course of many years. And by the 7-year mark, you have a brand new skeleton. So yes, cells can die all the time.
All right. Why are cells important?
Cells are important because they are actually what give... They are actually like the unit of life. So most things that don't have any cells aren't alive. So cells are really that thing that means... This thing is alive. This thing can breathe. It respirates. It does all sorts of movements just like us. So without cells, we wouldn't be here.
Awesome. We have our cells, red blood cells or white blood cells?
Ah, so there are red and white blood cells, and they look very different. In fact, I know you've heard the term white blood cells, but there are, I believe, 5 different types of white blood cells. So red blood cell is just one type. It floats around and delivers oxygen. That's its main role. And then you have a bunch of different types of white blood cells that do very specific things. And they're usually a lot bigger than those red blood cells.
Awesome. Now the next question, I'm actually going to also put out a poll and then we're going to move on. There's 2 questions. How many cells are in a plant? And also, how do you tell the difference between a plant and animal cell? And I'm going to put out a poll while she answers this question. If you guys would be interested, we might add to our schedule to go along with this one. Would you want to do another workshop on plant cells? All right, we're getting kind of 50-50 here.
So plant cells have a different organelle or structure called a cell wall. And so they actually, and how our cell membrane that we created was really fluid and wiggly, their cell wall is very structured. It's like a building cell, like a building room. It's square or geometric shape more so than it is wiggly. And they have another organelle called chloroplast, and that's how they make their energy, which is very different than our mitochondria, which is how we make our energy.
Awesome. Okay, let's go ahead and just let's make another organelle, and then we'll hit a bunch of questions because I see the questions pouring in. And actually, I think what I might do right now is just to see what you guys would prefer us to do. Would you like us to make more organelles or answer more questions? And this is going to be for after we do the next organelle. I'm going to see if you guys would like us to, and this isn't, we won't stop doing either, but if you want to do more questions or if you want us to spend more time, how would you like us to... spend more time making more organelles or answering more questions. That way you can let us know kind of what you would prefer, and we'll do that accordingly. All right, so the next organelle we want to do is?
Let's do the Golgi body.
Golgi body, all right. Is that the same as the Golgi apparatus or is that different?
It's the same as the Golgi apparatus, yes.
So we're going to do what is called the Golgi body or the Golgi apparatus. And what tool do you think we should use? Maybe the scribble?
It's very similar to the endoplasmic reticulum, so you could probably use the scribble.
Okay. It looks like it has more of the...
If I gave you a bigger picture of what it looks like.
Let's real quick, let's go and look up Golgi apparatus so we can see a more detailed picture of it. Golgi apparatus. So it actually looks a little bit more like this.
Yes.
So, wow.
And I think you could use the scribbles.
I have an idea.
Oh, you do?
Yeah.
I love it.
Cool. Let's try something. What we're going to do is we're going to do scribbles. We're going to start with scribbles. And I'm going to do my scribbles with the draw shape. You can do it with the other one, too, though. I think it'll be fine. And I'm going to kind of go like this. Just kind of go back and forth. I'm losing a little bit. Oh, no. But I think in the end, it'll kind of work out. Oh, it's kind of cool. And then I can just do it again to get the parts that I missed. So I can do this. And then, yeah, like that.
Oh, cool.
Kind of going back and forth here and getting those parts that I missed the first time. And then I'm going to use the pencil just to fill in some of that. So again, draw shape and pencil are our two tools. This is the scribbled object. So that's kind of what you want to do. I'm actually going to use the eraser because this looks a little bit too... That looks a little bit too round to me. So that looks good.
That looks great.
And now I'm going to do something interesting. I'm going to stop. And then I'm going to copy and paste that shape. I'm going to make it a little smaller. And I'm going to turn it into a hole. So to turn something into a hole, you see, when you select a shape, this little menu pops up. It says solid or hole. The second button is what you want to press. Oh, uh-oh. And I'm going to drag it over here. And I'm going to lift it up. And then I'm going to, so I have my hole. It's a smaller version of the scribble I already did. I'm going to select both. And you can do that either by holding shift after you select one and selecting the other. Or you could click and drag and just make sure both things you want to select fall in that box. And then up in the top right-hand corner here is a button with a circle and a square that have no line between them. And that's our group button. And so that's going to cut a little hole. And that kind of gets that shape. It's not perfect, you know, but it kind of gets that idea of there being holes in
there,
right?
That's so cool. No, I think that looks great.
So I'm going to then turn that pink like it is in the picture.
Wow.
And there's our Golgi apparatus. And we, I think, are ready for another poll that we have created for you guys. So we're going to check in with you now. And then we'll do some more questions. Let's see what the results of... Oh, I never started that poll. Uh-oh. All right. Would you like us to spend more time making more organelles or answering more questions? Let's see what you guys think. Oh.
Oh, no.
I've worded this question weird. Oh, no. Let me do a new poll.
Yes.
I'm sorry about that. Which would you... That's the kind of thing that happens when you're doing this on the fly. All right, which would you like us to spend more time doing? Let's word it that way. Making more organelles on Tinkercad or answering questions about cells. Let's try it this way. Create, and let's start that poll. Let's see what you guys like. That's kind of funny. All right. So far, it's kind of even, so I think we'll just do 50-50 then, like we have been. So we'll try to keep it even still. We still have some time, and we were thinking about doing this as just an hour, but we put in an hour and a half just so that if it got – we wanted to make sure that we had plenty of time to answer y'all's questions. So we'll hit some questions, but first I want to hear from you guys. What is your favorite organelle? I think we've talked about all these organelles so far, so let us know which organelle is your favorite. Nucleus?
Whoa, that changed so fast.
Yeah, it's getting close.
Jacob,
all right.
Do you have a favorite organelle?
My favorite is the Golgi apparatus.
You just like
and
the name.
I do like the name. Did you ever talk about what it does?
I didn't get a chance to.
All right, so before we hit questions, let's talk about what the Golgi apparatus does. And maybe some of you guys will change your mind about whether the Golgi apparatus is better than the nucleus.
So the Golgi apparatus is actually the transport system that the cell has. What it actually does, it's very interesting. So we can create proteins inside the cell, which is what the ribosomes do. So the ribosomes will create these big proteins, and then they'll ship those proteins, they'll throw them over to the Golgi apparatus, And that Golgi apparatus will actually wrap them up, package them in a lipid layer, and send them out of the cell. So just like you went to like FedEx or the you went to the post office and you had a package you wanted to deliver to someone, you would take that item, you'd put it in a box, put some tape around it, and give it to the post office, and they would send it out of the building or to out of the state and send it somewhere else. So that's what the Golgi apparatus does, is it prepares all sorts of molecules to be sent out of the cell to go to other cells all throughout the body.
Awesome. I love the Golgi apparatus. Okay. Let's look at some questions. What was the last one we saw? I think. Hold on. Okay, here we go. Do some of the cells on the picture have a different shape in other cells? So I guess the question is...
If the mitochondria might look different in one cell from another. Right. Not usually, no. It's just the quantity that changes.
Okay. Do cells have genes?
Yes, cells do have genes, and you're going to find those genes inside the nucleus, because what another word for genes are is DNA. So that's actually this genes, or our hereditary information, is all of our DNA.
Awesome.
And that's found where?
The nucleus slash nucleolus.
Very good!
It's in the nucleolus, which is in the nucleus,
yes,
right?
Yes, exactly. So both are right, yeah.
Okay. And just to clarify, we're talking about genes, G-E-N-E-S. Cells do not wear jeans. They don't wear denim.
They don't really like
But they
like
do
denim.
Have DNA genes.
They prefer like... leather pants.
That's silly humor. we're silly. Okay. What is the difference between smooth ER and rough ER? And can I try to answer this one? Because
yes.
I think I got it from doing the design of it.
Yes.
I think the only difference is that the rough ER has ribosomes on it. Has ribosomes. So these little balls that we put all over it. That is the only difference is that they have those on them. Now, whether their function is different?
Their function is. So you may have heard me say what ribosomes do. Do you remember what I said? If you don't, it's okay. It's okay. Like, so ribosomes actually make proteins.
Right.
So we find most of our ribosomes on our rough ER, and that is the site of protein synthesis or protein creation.
Okay.
So that's where most of us are creating our protein in our cells, is at our rough ER. So our smooth ER helps make lipids or fats, and our rough ER makes those proteins.
All right, so smooth is lipids or fats, and the rough is protein.
Correct.
I'm never going to forget that now. All right, so why are cells so important?
Well, we need them to be alive. Without cells, we would not be alive.
So could you say that they're kind of like the building blocks of life?
You could say that.
All right.
That's a textbook answer.
Awesome. I feel like that's why it was in my head. It's because it's from my textbook from high school. Okay. What do cells need to survive?
Oh, that's a really good question. So cells need water. They need energy, so like glucose. They also need maybe protein. It depends on the cell and its function, but most of the time they also need like a certain level of sodium or potassium. So they have a lot of different ions that they require, and that's why when we eat food, it's very similar to what do we need to survive. Well, it's a lot of different vitamins and minerals and water that we eat and we intake. And that's all that stuff is what our cells intake. So that's why we require it, is because our cells require it.
Okay. Let's see. What is the smallest cell?
Oh, that's good.
Well, look at that. We found the biggest cell. So now we're looking for the smallest cell. We got that question a few times. So I'm glad we're answering it. I see also another one of my favorite questions of all time is, I love this. Thank you. We love this too. This is so fun. So let's see, the smallest cell.
I'm looking it up right now.
I'm
going to look up what the smallest bacterial cell is.
We'll look for the smallest bacterial cell. What is the smallest animal that is made of one cell?
Ah, yes.
Let's look that up.
What is the smallest single-cell organism?
Let's go with that. Let's see. Do fungi have cells? We'll go after that in a second after you found it.
I did. Right. So the smallest single-celled organism is called mycoplasma, and that is actually a very tiny cell, and that's actually one of the things. I used to work in research at UTMB, and sometimes you would get a, which sounds ridiculous, sometimes you would get like a growth in your cell tissue cultures of mycoplasma, and that pretty much meant that you couldn't, because you couldn't filter it, because they were so small, they could fit through filters. And so you would have to get rid of your entire sample line and start over if you had a mycoplasma. So like they're very, very small.
Mycoplasma, okay.
Yes, myco meaning fungus.
Oh, do fungi have cells?
Fungi do have cells.
Everything that's alive.
Everything that's alive has cells.
And then, or it is a cell.
Correct.
The next one, can we make a digital workshop on robots? Yes, we're doing that next week, so look out for that. Every time we do the Tinkercad Basics workshop, which right now I think we're just doing in the mornings, but the schedule might change next week. Every time we do the basics is with a different theme. So this morning we did dream houses. On Thursday we're doing playgrounds, but next week we have vehicles and robots and all sorts of other fun stuff coming up. We can review. We'll review in just a minute. Someone didn't get the poll. How do you make the scribble multicolored? That is a good question. I think you have to do separate scribbles. I don't think you can do different colors all in one scribble. So when you look at my rough and smooth ER over here, what I did is I have two different scribbles and I made them different colors using the color option here. So let's go ahead and review real quick. Somebody asked if we could review, and that's a great idea. So we started by making our outer membrane.
Yes, our cell membrane.
Our cell membrane, which is what kind of protects the cell and holds it all together.
Yes, that's right.
And holds it all together. Then we used the scribble tool for that. Then we made the nuclear membrane, the nucleus, and the nucleolus, all using the cylinder tool. Mm-hmm. And that's basically a big protection system for DNA?
Yes, okay. DNA or our genes.
Our genes, exactly.
G-E-N-E.
Yeah, not denim genes. We're not talking denim genes here. Then I think what we did next was our mitochondria, mm-hmm. which...
The half cylinder.
We used the half sphere and we stretched it and we turned it upside down. And those are the things that
are the powerhouse of the cell.
Powerhouse of the cell.
They break down glucose into energy that our cell can
use. Create energy, which is stored.
Which is then, if we don't use that energy, can be built up into a big fat molecule.
Right. Is that within the smooth ER here?
Yes,
so
it is.
So the smooth ER does that, and then does it get?
And then, the fat molecule can be sent out of the cell to the Golgi. So it goes to the Golgi apparatus, and the Golgi apparatus can package it to send it out of the cell.
Oh, okay. So, yeah.
It can
so
also store it in the cell
there.
As well. Yes.
So these three work. I think all the organelles kind of work together, but those three have, that's a direct route from here to here to here.
Yes.
And then, so we made our smooth and our rough endoplasmic reticulum. And the rough one, the difference is that they have these little ribosomes all over it, which produce protein.
Yes, you did.
I am learning a lot today with you guys too. And these ribosomes can also be elsewhere on the cell. And that's all we made. The Golgi apparatus is over here. We also used we're doing a lot of scribbling today because really cells are made up of it seems.
Yes, yes, that's
lots
that's
of
a
scribbles.
Scientific fact.
Yeah. All right. Let's see what else we have. How do you make the scribble? How did you make the hole shape squiggle? Okay, so let's go back over how we do holes real quick, just in case you guys wanted to do that. It's not necessary to do it, but what you do is once you have a scribble, you can copy and paste it, and your second scribble, make it smaller using these little corner buttons here. And then turn it into a hole. And once you have a hole, let's just do a quick tutorial of what a hole looks like. So you have a solid object, and then you can turn a solid object into a hole. So I have a solid and a hole here. You select both. You can either hold shift and select both, or use click and drag to make a little box around both of them. And finally, anywhere that overlaps between the solid and the hole is what's going to get cut out. So you want to overlap it however you want it to be cut out. And then you press group. And so there you see how a hole works. All right. Do we want to answer a couple more questions, or do we want to make another organelle?
Let's make one more organelle. I think we have time for one more.
Let's do one more organelle, and then we'll spend the rest of the time answering y'all's questions.
Let's do the vacuole.
The vacuole. It's in the bottom left. It looks like there's a few of them around.
Actually, I lied. Let's do the lysosome.
Let's do the lysosome. Those are perfect cylinders, and those, it looks like in this cell, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. We have six of them. Do we have to do six?
No, you don't have to do six. It depends on the cell.
It depends on the cell. And those look like perfect. Do you think circles or spheres?
I think spheres would work just fine.
Okay, let's do spheres. So we'll make a sphere. We'll make it smaller. And the way we'll differentiate between this, I think they're going to be a little bigger.
They are a little bigger than ribosomes.
And we'll also have them be a different color. And we'll do pink like it is in the picture. There we go.
Awesome.
So all we did was create a sphere. We made it smaller, and then we changed the color. And I'm going to then go ahead and start copying and pasting them and just putting them around. And it seems like, is there a minimum amount of these that you need in a cell?
We need at least one.
So there needs to be at least one of these.
Yes.
Okay.
Because what they do is they actually have digestive enzymes in them. So it's kind of like the cell's stomach. And what that does is it's going to take anything that enters the cell that the cell doesn't, that the cell wants to break down. The vacuole is going to come over and engulf whatever that is and break it down into smaller molecules.
Awesome. Awesome. Okay.
That looks great.
So we got vacuoles. Now there's a few things we didn't make. So if you guys want to look up just an animal cell and keep adding the different parts, that's fine. I think there's even stuff that's not pictured here.
Yes,
right?
There is more things. There is a lot.
It can get very complicated. We chose a kind of simple one because we didn't even get all the way through it. But that's totally fine. If you guys want to keep going after this, please do share it with us afterwards. You can take a picture. And a quick note about Tinkercad, because I get this question a lot, you don't need to press anything to save. It automatically saves. So if you X out your window, everything you did will still be there when you come back. And when the museum is back open again, if you guys want to come by and sign into your Tinkercad, we can 3D print a little tiny version of the cell that you made today. So once we're open again, please, if you participated here and you have a cell you designed, come on over and 3D print your cell. And now we're just going to kind of go through the questions. We have about 20 more minutes left.
Sounds
and
great.
Then any other questions you have, you can reach out to us, or we're going to be doing this for the foreseeable future until the museum is open again. So you can always come back and ask more questions then. So let's see where we were. There's a question about the hole shape. So the Golgi apparatus is basically the post office.
Yes, it is.
Yes, it is. That is awesome.
They call it the packaging house of the cell. So that's exactly what it is.
Perfect. Post office, UPS, FedEx, whatever your preference
Amazon
is.
Amazon Prime.
Why do they have different shapes?
Those shapes are determined from when scientists took pictures, microscopic pictures of the organelles. And if you were to like Google some of those pictures, they're all black and white because that microscope has to go so far and make it so much bigger for us to even see it. And that was the kind of shape that they were able to determine. And so they used simple shapes to represent what they saw on their microscope.
Cool.
Yeah.
All right. Do different animals have different cells?
Yes, actually, lots of different animals have different cells. For instance, like we have cells in our lungs, and fish don't have any lungs. They have gills. So they're going to have a different type of cell that helps them, that represents their aeration system within their own body. And it's going to be very different than what our lung cells look like.
I think this is, can DNA be made outside that nucleus?
That is a wonderful question. In fact, DNA synthesis is my favorite topic.
Oh, boy.
So DNA is usually not found outside of the nucleus. In fact, you can, what usually happens is DNA is made copies of inside the nucleus. There's actually a ribosome or a there's what's called a transfer RNA that can take the translated DNA into RNA, and it takes that RNA out of the nucleus, but only after it's been translated into RNA.
Okay.
And that's like the big difference here. So most DNA stays inside the cell nice and safe because we don't want that DNA to get damaged. Because if you damage the DNA, then you can't read the story of what it's supposed to, the cell's supposed to do.
Okay. DNA. So next we're on, does the animal cell look like the human cell?
Yes.
Question.
So that animal cell that we just made is a representation of cells we see in our bodies, and almost every cell we see in our bodies. Right. The number of mitochondria might change, the number of lysosomes or rhizosomes may change, but it's still a representation of each cell we see in our body. So yes, the animal cell is exactly like, looks like the human cells we have.
Yep. We already talked about, can DNA be made outside the nucleus? That isn't a question. Do you play Minecraft? We sometimes use Minecraft on the museum before. We've used it before. Let's see. Which animal has the biggest cells? Well, I would say the biggest cell would be the single-celled organism that is the biggest cell, the one that we looked at. I forgot what it was called, but I can go back here.
It was fragilisome.
Right.
Yes.
So this would be the animal with the biggest cell because it literally is the biggest cell.
Yes.
So I think that is our answer there. We can review right at the end here. So we're going to keep going. I learned so much today. I love
that.
Yes. Do kids have the same number of cells as adults?
No, you don't. In fact, like as you get taller or wider, you get more cells. That's actually, so the bigger you are, usually the more cells you have.
Okay. Someone asked if we could show the cell diagram. Here it is. I'll just have it up on the screen from now on. I'll just make this smaller and we can kind of go through here. That should work. So I'll keep that up. And if you want to look that up too, it's just an image we just chose. You could probably, I think if you Google animal cell, it's like, it's in the top few images. And again, we are going to review right at the end before we stop. And let's see what else we got. Can you show the cell diagram? How many ribosomes are in a cell?
That is a good question. It depends on the type of cell. So if that cell is actually geared to make more protein, you're going to find more ribosomes in that cell. But let's say that cell isn't made for that. That cell is made to do more respiration, which is like how we breathe. So it's going to have more mitochondria in it instead of more ribosomes. So it just depends on the type of cell. So the specific number I wouldn't be able to quantify.
All right. We have some great comments here about how fun this is. That's awesome. We're having a lot of fun too, actually.
Yes.
Does the size of the animal, I think we talked about this. Yes, the size of the animal does affect.
Yes.
The bigger an animal is, generally, will be the more cells it has. Is that specific? Because if they have different kinds of cells, like would a dog possibly have less cells than something that's slightly smaller than a different animal?
Yeah.
But usually size is
like
a good,
tree. Like if you saw like a big oak tree, it has far more cells than like you or me.
Right.
Because it's much bigger and their cells are just as small as our cells.
Okay. How do cells reproduce?
That is a very good question. They produce two different ways. There's mitosis and meiosis. Those are very different ways. So what usually happens is one of the structures you see in our animal cell picture is you see the centrosome. It's actually the top right word in our diagram. And that centrosome, there's actually a few of them in our cells, and they actually help the cell pull apart and actually split into two. What's going to happen before they can even reproduce or turn into two is they're going to make a copy of their DNA inside that nucleolus. And so we're going to end up with two copies of that DNA, and that nucleus is actually going to collapse over that and create two nucleuses. It's going to create more mitochondria.
Wow.
It's going to create more ER. And so so each cell will be prepared once you split off to be their own individual cell again.
So, yeah. They split.
They split, exactly.
All right.
There you go.
To summarize, they split. So there's some funny questions. Some about, someone says, this blows my mind. It blows my mind, too.
Me too. Cells are my favorite thing to talk about.
It's so
I don't
cool.
know if you can tell.
Yeah. And this is all the information about the cells, you can tell, is all Allie. I'm learning this as we go. I'm just kind of the TinkerCAD expert here.
But the TinkerCAD is so cool. Yeah, too. It's so very I'm learning fun. About TinkerCAD.
When is the next Dreamhouse TinkerCAD? I don't know when we're going to do Dreamhouse next. We are doing Playgrounds next, and that'll be on Thursday morning. But I also think that that is totally full, so there's no space left in that one. We are going to be adding more of these, so there will be more opportunities for you guys to do this. How does a snow leopard cell look?
Well, honestly, they're going to look very similar to our cells because snow leopards are warm-blooded mammals, so they're going to have blood cells, they're going to have muscle cells and bone cells and skin cells and hair cells. And all of those cells are going to look very similar to our blood, muscle, skin, hair. All of those cells are going to be very similar because they move just as much as we do. They're warm blooded. So it's a very similar comparison.
Okay. Somebody asked if they said their iPad died. It will save. Again, everybody, this is awesome. For thing about Tinkercad is that it automatically is just saving everything you do as you go. So if your iPad died or if your computer dies and you didn't get to exit out, it should have saved pretty much everything you did. Sometimes it'll miss like the last action you took, but it pretty much saves everything you've done. Are there any living things that do not have cells?
No.
So,
you have to have a cell to be alive. Okay.
So I guess in a way, you could say single-celled organisms don't have cells. They are cells.
They are a cell.
But
so maybe the cells plural is really where the finite answer is. So you can be a cell and be alive, but if you don't have any cells, you're not alive.
Okay. Are all animal cells the same? We kind of went over this, and I'm going to try to answer it based on the answer because I'm trying to learn too, so
no,
please
great.
Correct me. But there are different kinds of animal cells. There's skin cells, blood cells, and so they're not all the same. And that's as far as I got. So
that's perfect. Okay. No, you're right. Not all animal cells are the same.
Okay,
that's
awesome. Does water have cells?
So that's a very good question, and it's kind of particular. I'm going to say water molecules do not have cells. So if you were to pour completely pure water, and that's all that was in there was water, it would have no cells. But if you were to go to a pond and get a cup of that water, you would find a lot of living creatures inside that water that are just one cell. That does not mean that they are the water, but lots of single-celled organisms can live in that water. Does that make sense?
Yeah, that makes sense.
Good.
So cells are really irregular.
Yes, they are.
that's a good observation. They're kind of like blobs, right?
Yes, I
mean,
they are.
Even the shape of them is irregular.
And they can change shape and size depending on the type of environment they're in.
Okay. How many different cells do we have?
Oh my goodness. That's
we're gonna look that answer up for you. Someone asked, when does the museum open? I believe you can find that information online. So we'll try to point you towards that.
200 different types of cells.
That is, I was expecting more than that.
Me too. Yeah,
200 different types of cells.
In humans, there are about 200 different types of cells. And within these cells, there are about 20 different types of structures or organelles, which is what we've been building today.
Awesome. How many xenobots have been created?
How many xenobots?
We'll look into that for you. But I'm going to move down. So this animal cell, I don't know if it has a specific one. It doesn't say what animal cell it is. So you can look up specific ones, I believe.
Yes, you can.
But
this one is just the generalization of the organelles inside an animal cell.
So it's not a specific animal cell that we are. I mean, it might be a specific animal cell, but it doesn't say what one it is. Are cells found in another place other than the cell kingdom?
Cells found other than, no. So you're just going to find them in the living kingdoms. If you're talking about kingdom, phylum, classification.
The classification of
living
things.
Cells will be in every classification that has a living thing in it.
So About how many cells would you find, and I'm going to kind of add to this question, like a 5 centimeter. Let's just talk about skin cells. How many skin cells would you find in a 5 centimeter by 5 centimeter area?
That's a really good question.
And we're looking into it right now, guys. Somebody else is asking about 3D printing. So again, if you want to 3D print your creations, once the museum is back open again, we will make a big announcement. You will know all about it. And you can come by the Maker Annex and say, hey, I participated in the animal cell workshop. I have my TinkerCAD account right here, and we will help you put that on our 3D printer so you can print out a little. It's going to be a small, but it'll be bigger than an actual cell. We won't print it at whatever tiny size you said a cell was earlier. We'll make it a little bit bigger so you
can
see
it. Without a microscope.
Yeah, but we will 3D print it for you.
There are about 19 million skin cells in every inch of your skin.
So let's say, other than 5 centimeter by 5 centimeter.
Which is like half an inch.
Is that about half an inch?
I could be wrong.
Let's look up real quick.
Guys, I'm a science major, not a
5 centimeter to inches. That's easy enough. Let's see. Oh, it's about 2 inches.
Oh, okay, good. So 19, I'm going to round up to 20 million and go 40
million.
So about
40 million cells are in 5 centimeters by 5 centimeters. Obviously, that's an estimation, but that is just around what you'll find. How can a cell grow?
So actually, cells grow because the way they split, they just get big enough that they can split into two. They don't grow to be much bigger than that, at least our cells. Some single-celled organisms are different, but cells that live in a multicellular animal would actually, they don't grow to be much bigger than whatever they're going to be. And the reason why is because they end up having too much water inside of them, and they can't live that long like that. So, yeah.
Awesome. Somebody asked, does that mean elephants also have big cells? Can I try this one?
Yeah, you try it.
I think it means that elephants have more cells.
Yes.
I don't think the size of the cells depends on the size of the animal. There are cells that are different sizes, but bigger animals generally will have more cells than smaller animals.
Yes, that's exactly it.
Hooray! Let's see. Someone said, fun! I agree. Drones, robots, RC planes. Yes, we'll do that soon. Where do you learn all this on cells? How do you know so much about cells, Allie? Tell us.
So I actually am I majored in biology with an emphasis in biochemistry. And then I did a lot of work in the microbiology labs. And so ultimately that means you go to college, you go to high school first. You learn all about biology in your biology classes. And then you take more biology in your college classes, and you keep doing it till it becomes your job, and now you get to talk about cells while they build them on TinkerCAD.
Yep. It's a straight line.
It's exactly
Do cells explode?
So cells don't normally explode, no, but they do something that's called the apoptosis, which is where cells commit death. They kill themselves in a sense, which sounds really dark. But what really that means is that means their DNA, if we get like a sunburn and our skin is like, you know, when you get a sunburn, they say you have to watch out for things like skin cancer. What prevents skin cancer is your own cells. So what they'll do is they'll realize, oh, my DNA has been damaged. And so they'll stop reproducing. And that's all apoptosis means, is that they're not going to split into two again.
Okay.
Yeah.
What do earthworm cells look like?
That's a great question.
Do you want to try to find them? Let's see. Earthworm cell. Let's see if we can get y'all a picture of an earthworm cell.
That is an earthworm split in half.
Okay.
That's just a bisection. A bisection of an earthworm.
So do earthworm cells, do they basically look like other animal cells?
They will. They might be, depending on the earthworms are segmented worms. So their cells might be a little bit different than like our own skin cells, but they're going to have similar organelles.
Okay.
Yeah.
Do cells have cells?
That's a really good question. They don't have cells. So there's a few different hypotheses of like how we ended up with what's called an animal cell. Because if you notice, the nucleus is made of that same phospholipid bilayer as the phospholipid bilayer cell membrane. And one of the hypotheses or theories that scientists have is that a cell ate another cell, and that's how we ended up with the nucleus. And then they learned how to live together like that. It's called like a symbiotic relationship of a cell inside a cell. And that's actually what happened after a long time of evolution, is now we have the nucleus, which maybe used to be another cell. But we don't, but most of the time cells do not live inside of other cells.
Okay. Let's see what else we got. Is there going to be more lessons? Yes, there will be more lessons. We have two scheduled for Thursday, though they are filling up fast. We still have room in our 3D figures, which we're going to have Jen helping us out in doing some fun math with TinkerCAD. Very fun math, actually. And then we're going to be scheduling more for next week, and we're going to try to get as many in as we can so we can see as many people as we can. So there's going to be even more next week than there were this week, and just kind of try to build it from there. Can you explain vacuoles?
Yes. So vacuoles are actually just kind of storage containers. So it's where we might store some of those fat cells we make from our smoothie jar. It may also be where we keep some of our proteins that the cell might use later, or some waste. So sometimes whenever we're breaking down our glucose molecule, we actually produce some waste molecules. And that waste can be picked up by those vacuoles, and then the vacuoles will adhere to the cell membrane and release it into like the stream around the cell so it can be excreted later.
Okay, vacuoles. Someone asked, is this recording going to be on YouTube? I don't know where we're going to be uploading the recording, but it will be available, I believe. So I'll send out a message about that once it happens. It is being recorded, and we are going to make it available. Are bones made up of cells?
Yes, they are.
Yay!
So we have bone cells. They look kind of different, but they have nucleuses and all sorts of things.
Someone said they never knew cells are so complicated. Neither did I. We're all learning here. Apparently, Allie already knew that, though.
Oh, I don't know. I'm doing a lot of Googling when y'all ask. I don't know how many cells you can find on an inch of skin or anything
like
that.
Are there different types of types of cells in plants or animals? Yes, animal cells are different from plant cells.
Yes.
And we're actually thinking about doing another one of these just about plant cells.
Which will be just as much fun.
Yeah. Someone said, I can feel my brain cells duplicating.
Yes!
That is awesome. Me too. Can you explain the rest of the cells in the diagram? What did we not get to?
I'm looking.
We did lysosomes.
We did lysosomes. We did the centrioles. So the one thing I think we didn't talk about was the cytoplasm, and that's the word in black on the top right side. I had to make sure I was saying the right direction of the picture. And so cytoplasm is actually a jelly-like fluid that fills the entire cell. And so that membrane holds that jelly there. And so that's how things kind of transfer in and out. Some things can kind of squish or move around. So like those proteins that need to get to that Golgi apparatus move through that jelly. So it's like the glucose molecules that we use for energy. And I think we covered everything else. Yeah,
we got to all of them. That's kind of surprising. I think we have time for one more question, and then we're going to have to say goodbye for today. But let's see. Let's see if we can find one more question to look at. Show me a snow leopard cell. Let's find one that we can I think you could probably Google that, but I think, again, all these cells kind of look the same.
I see. Why is it called a cell?
Why is it called a cell? Let's go with that.
Okay.
That's a great way to end this.
So a cell is actually named after one of the early people who were looking at cells on a microscope. It was a very old, like, it's a very rough form of a microscope. That's what I'm trying to say, is it wasn't like our microscopes we use today that can zoom in really much. No, this was a guy who was sitting and he was looking at cork cells. So cork is like a type of material that is a plant and has cells. And he says it looked like a small monastery because it looked like little structured blocks, because he was looking at plant cells, not animal cells.
Oh.
And so the idea of a cell being where the individual monks actually lived, that's actually the name of where they lived, was different cells.
It's fascinating.
Yes.
Wow. So it's because plant cells, and maybe we'll get into this when we go to the plant cell. We'll talk about this more. Because we'll actually be able to see that it looks like that. So plant cells are more
structured. They're much more square, rectangular.
I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Okay, very cool. All right, guys, I pretty sure you guys learned a lot based on what I'm seeing. So, oh no, don't go. We have to. I'm sorry, but we will be doing more of these.
Yes.
So definitely look out. We'll be posting about it on Facebook. Anyone who's on our mailing list, we already send these out to you. Anyone who wants to be on our mailing list, just let me know. You can send me an email and I'll add you to our mailing list specifically for the Maker Annex. We're also putting this on our e-blasts with CMH. So if you are subscribed to that, you'll see all about this. So thank you guys so much. We had so much fun today.
Thank you.
Yeah, bye.
Bye.